Hello and welcome to the Computer Guru Show. My name is Mike, here to deal with your technology needs and treat you like a person in the process. Don't know how to deal with cables and cords in here, but sure, I can help you with your technology issues.
As long as they're cordless.
Yeah, cordless issues only, please. Just because we were just sitting here, you know, chatting about and then heard the show music start. And I'm like, you know what? I don't have any headphones at all.
I guess we'll go ahead and just do the show now.
You know what? Let's not do the show today. Let's just...
Going home?
Let's go home. Can you play last week's?
A little late.
Let's not.
Oh, okay. All right, 790-2040 if you want to be part of the show. It's 520-790-2040 if you'd like to ask us a technology question, see if we can help you out. Because that's what we do. That's what we're here for.
In theory.
Theoretically speaking.
Sometimes we might have to be like, we'll fix that for you later. Because it's not radio friendly.
That's right. So, all right, guys, what's first? Lay it on me. Let's do it.
Well, we could talk about how HP suddenly decided that maybe they were a little too hasty with the whole, you know, let's nerf third-party ink thing.
All right. How did they respond?
By basically just being like, yeah, we were definitely wrong on that one. Please don't sue us.
Oh, and here's your firmware update to fix it?
Yeah, we'll have that out, like, ASAP.
Right on. Is it out?
I think they said it was going to be out within a couple of weeks on their support forums.
I wonder how many printers will be replaced by then.
Probably a lot, honestly.
Oh, man, I'm sure brother is
That's what I was just about to say. This whole thing makes me want to say, oh, brother. No, those brother printers, though, that's the way to go.
They're nice printers.
Get a laser printer, by the way. You don't need that inkjet.
Yeah, I mean, I tell people this all the time, so maybe we should make it into the show. Stop buying inkjet printers. They're just, it's such a waste.
Especially, like, if you're not printing color all the time, you know, just get a black and white laser printer.
Yeah, and even if you are printing, like, document colors, like, you know, like, you want to print your text in pretty colors, get a color laser printer. I mean, the only time that you should have any type of ink printer is if you're spending $1,000 on that really nice sort of photo printer. Other than that, it's such a waste.
Yeah, for sure. Those photo printers, though, I mean, you do need to spend a good amount of money on those things for them to come out nice.
Yeah, I guess if you're... Oh, look at me failing. I have failed. By the way, I'm supposed to be doing the show right now.
Which laptop was that made the noise? Mike has 4,000 laptops on the table.
I do not have 4,000 laptops. There are 4 laptops on the table, but some of them are your guys's.
One is mine.
Yep. You still have 2 laptops for just you.
One's for the chat so I can see it.
Actually, that's a good use.
I need dual screens, baby.
And I've got my laptop here because, in theory, we're going to have the podcast up the way that I've been trying to get it set up for weeks. And if everything goes right, it will be up today this time.
Unlike last week, which should be up today.
Well, yeah, last week's podcast, also up today, no matter what.
Okay. All right, 790-2040 if you want to be part of the show. So HP says, so sorry.
We messed up. You guys are right. Please don't sue our pants off. We need those.
They're still going to get sued. You know they're going to get sued.
Well, I mean, I they should be because their firmware update literally destroyed ink cartridges.
Yeah.
And those aren't cheap, even if you're buying third-party ones.
Yeah, they're definitely not. The cost per ink is like $500 a gallon.
Honestly, what I've been doing is I just try to make my ink last a year, and then I buy a new printer every Black Friday.
Really?
Yep.
Does it actually last a year?
Usually. The color, maybe not so much, but I don't print very often. So, or I'll just use your printer at the shop.
Oh.
Now we know.
It's more true than I'd like to admit.
New deduction.
No wonder my printing bills have been so high at the shop.
Well, last time I asked for a raise, you were like, you can use the printer. How about that?
You get some printer action. There you go. All right. So if you want to be part of the chat, you can also get in on that. You can go to guruShow.com/chat. It gives you an opportunity to... ask questions, comment,
say things that you wouldn't be able to say if you called in.
Right, because that definitely happens a lot in the chat.
Which is okay. I mean, I kind of like that because people get to speak their minds there.
Yeah, there's a little more free exchange of ideas there, we'll say.
I like to get in the chat when I'm not on the show just so that I control you guys.
Very nice. All right. What was the other one? There was something else that I definitely wanted to talk about, like first segment stuff.
Sorry, I keep providing you with so many notes.
Well, that's true. that's true. Now, did we talk about the game developer that Valve kicked out?
I don't think we did.
All right, so it turns out that there's this game developer, and they've been actually banned from Steam, which is, I don't know how you do that. Well, actually, I do by this article, but it just seems to me like, why? Why would you do that? I mean, how does one do that? And what were they thinking? So basically, this game came out, and it wasn't very great. It wasn't wonderful. And so Steam gives you the opportunity to give some feedback. Right? To players get an opportunity to rate the game, give it a review, so everybody else knows what that set of people thought about it.
Yeah, and usually that review system is a pretty integral part of purchasing a game on Steam, because you're going to get, you know, the real truth about the game, not just what the developer tells you.
Well, the developer was so unhappy with negative reviews that they started suing people that gave them negative reviews. And
you got to be pretty upset.
Yeah, they're really, really angry people.
Well, okay, so were these reviews legitimate reviews of the game, or were these people just like, this developer personally sucks?
All right, so they started out with, this game is terrible.
Right.
And then the developer got involved and started basically commenting on everything, telling everybody who didn't like the game that they were no good. To which the internet world responded with, oh yeah, let's go ahead and tell you what we really think. Or let's go ahead and make up what we think just to hurt your feelings. And so that type of response then led them to getting the courts involved, because they were saying they were getting threats. And I don't know that they were, I mean, the internet is full of threats, because that's what the internet is.
The guy probably did get some threats. I don't know about credible ones, but.
Well, it turns out that even like EA, deservedly, yeah, gets all kinds of threats about their games, and they're just like, I just want to go burn that building down because I wasted $60 on this game.
Is that a threat, though?
I don't know. I mean, by internet standards, no.
Yeah, I guess that's for the courts to decide.
Right, but by you know, someone in their safe space standards, sure. Yeah, that's a threat. But I think that most people know that, you know, some 12-year-old that's 3,000 miles away from the developer's office is not going to come burn the building down. And so anyway, the courts are involved now, and Steam's response is, well, you know, you're kind of not being nice to our user base, so get out.
And they can totally do that. They can ban you for any reason that they want to. Although I don't know that they needed to, because if you mess up on Steam with the community, you're basically done anyway. You know, once you burn your name on Steam, you're not going to get your game out there.
Yeah. I mean, I look at those reviews. Every time that I've purchased a game on Steam, you know, those reviews are very important. Because I'll go and I'll read.
I dislike the attempt at humor that Valve kind of embraced.
Allows.
You know, how they have the funny reviews.
Right.
Like, I get it, you know, but sometimes I just want to read a real comprehensive review of the game.
Well, luckily they mark the fake ones.
Yeah.
For the most part. They say, by the way, this one's humorous review. This is not, it may or may not be true.
Yeah, and you can actually sort by, you know, removing the funny ones.
I think that's an important system to have, and for this reason, right? This developer made a not great game, and after a string of not great games, and people were frustrated with the quality of those games, and the community wins, man.
Well, you know, we were just talking at the shop the other day about how, remember back in the day when games used to have demos instead of, like, paid betas?
Yeah. Like every game from EA lately.
Yeah. No, you used to be able to just download a demo and see if you wanted to play the game. Now that's called piracy.
Yeah.
You just pirate the game.
It's still, you know, it's not the recommended way, but it's still a very good way of testing out a game before you purchase it.
I have to say that I'm the type of person where if I were to pirate a game...
Hypothetically speaking.
Yeah, hypothetically. Not in the real world, of course.
Right.
If I really liked that game and I saw that I was getting multiple hours of play, I would go buy that game. But it's a good way to test it out, in theory.
Yeah, I think they should bring the demos back.
Yeah, for sure.
You get, like, the first level, you know, to go do your thing.
I also like when developers let you pirate a game, but, like, they just make it impossible to play in some subtle way.
Yeah, and there's some good games that have done that over the years.
Like Batman, the new Batman Arkham Asylum game or something like that. It was one of those games. They made it to where his cape couldn't glide if you pirated the game. So you'd jump off a building and just die.
That's
this
nice.
Developer, though, now is trying to sue for defamation and whatnot. And he has a GoFundMe account.
I bet that's going to get a lot of money.
It has $450 of $75,000.
Hey, that's a non-zero amount.
It is a non-zero amount. It might as well be a zero amount. Cause
he should have to take that $450 and refund all the people who purchased his game.
Now, I don't know really how GoFundMe works. Does it work like Kickstarter, where if you don't reach your goal, you don't get the money?
Correct.
Okay.
Yeah, so if you don't...
So he's not going to get this.
If you don't get the goal, you don't get funded.
Caveat, I think that there's, just like on Kickstarter now, you can set up a campaign where you do get whatever amount that you...
Why would you do that?
Ask for. Well, I don't know, because some people know that they're not going to reach their goal.
Then they should set lower expectations for themselves.
I agree.
He should have set a goal for $450.
I'm generally not in favor of Kickstarter anyway.
Okay, why?
Vaporware and, you know, all that. There's a lot of money grabs on Kickstarter.
There's stuff that are never going to be anything more than ideas.
Yeah. Yeah.
Or like they're just lame.
There
like
was
the guy
whole,
who wanted to make potato salad.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay, occasionally there's a funny one like that. But, I mean, that guy got, like, a massive amount of funding, too.
Yeah, and then he did, in fact, throw a giant potato salad party.
I'd go to that
for
party.
For everyone who did his Kickstarter.
Okay. So anyway,
but then there's people like the guy who made the, I don't remember, it was like the Triton gill thing where it like makes you be able to breathe under, and it was just scientifically unsound and would never work and you would die if you used it.
Well, according to Thunderfoot, you know, even the Hyperloop isn't going to work.
Well, I mean, you know what? I have to say, I questioned it a little bit after watching that video because he does his research.
All right.
I'll link that in the show chat.
Let's take a moment to mention our sponsor. That would be Perfection Auto Works. You can visit their website at perfectionautoworks.com. And, you should go check them out. They do a 26-point inspection for free, and they make your car run beautifully, lovely even. Yeah.
It's perfection.
It is perfection. Yeah, so check them out. Their ad is coming up next, right here on the Computer Guru Show. We'll be right back.
Your computer guru, Mike Swanson, is here to help you tame that beast of a machine. Join the chat right now at guruShow.com or call in. This is the Computer Guru Show on KVOY, The Voice. Your technology guru, Mike Swanson, is answering all your questions one by one.
Yes, science!
So chime in with yours. The website is guruShow.com. Tune in, click in, and kick back. This is the Computer Guru Show.
Welcome back to the Computer Guru Show, 790-2040. That's 520-790-2040 if you want to be part of the show. Let's talk about ransomware for a minute, shall we?
Sounds good.
According to AVG, who's doing a bunch of research on this, 1 in 3 businesses have no clue what ransomware is or how just devastating it can be to your business.
I would say that based on our experience with businesses, that's probably an accurate number, if not a low estimate.
I think it's low. I think that because a lot of the businesses that we go into and we take over, they don't have any type of adequate protection, and users just, they're like, oh, well, you know, I got the zip in the email. I'm just going to go ahead and execute it. Let's go ahead and open it up.
You know, that one in particular always blows my mind, because it's like everybody knows not to open zip files.
Except everybody doesn't know.
In my mind, everybody does, though, because it's so... It's like such an old one. Like, don't click the giant green button.
Right. Well, I mean, if you happen to have your mail hosted through Arizona Computer Guru, you don't get zips in email.
You know, it actually, me and Howard were trying to send each other legitimate zip files, like work-related stuff.
Nope.
And we couldn't figure out why it wasn't working.
The mail server strips out zip files because I'm just, no.
Howard was like, I know, I attached it.
He should know.
Well, it just took us longer than expected to realize that that was what was going on.
Yeah, it's been in place for so long, I don't think anybody thinks about it. But executables, zip files, screensaver files, all immediately stripped out by the mail server. Just, nope, not happening.
Yeah, I think that one's even lesser known, the whole image thing, how you can hide an executable inside of an image. People should know about that.
You can say something, Ken? You look like you...
Oh, I was just going to say the RAR files. Do you strip those, too?
No, I don't strip RARs because they almost never come in RARs.
Yeah. And also, I feel like somebody who doesn't know not to open a zip file isn't going to have software to open a RAR file.
That's right. So, yeah, I only strip out the stuff that is commonly infected. And some of the clients, I can't believe people still send zip files, actually. It's just like, really?
Now, so on one hand, I'm like, more people should know about this. But on the other hand, I'm like, you know, the less people know about this, the better we do as a business. So.
Yeah. But at the same time, I would rather people be educated and then call for help in getting that protection.
Yeah.
Rather than after the fact and have to go in there and be like, well, you either pay the ransom or you say goodbye to all your data.
And in a lot of cases, that's the exact end result. I've heard about it many times, especially in the shop, where it's like, well, you didn't have any shadow copies, and this thing just encrypted all of your files. So
yeah, no backups, no shadow copies. I mean, if you have a business server, there are some very specific things that should be turned on that machine. Like, first of all, nobody should be logging in as an administrative account. Nobody. Stop using servers as workstations. Let's start with that one. And then beyond that, you should make sure that shadow copies are enabled. You should make sure that you have an on-site and an off-site backup. And like we had one last week where they called us because of ransomware. And it's a terabyte of data that's just gone. And we ended up having to pull a copy off of Carbonite. But that's a week gone. Right, to pull a terabyte off of Carbonite is easily 3 days worth of transferring and restoring. And so it's one of those things. It's like, can you afford to be down for multiple days on end?
Probably not.
Yeah, most people can't. And so, I mean, they only had one server, one copy of the data, and it was all encrypted. And all because a user had more access to data than they should have. And it's... I guess I see it sometimes where people, they just get their feelings hurt. They're like, well, I should have access to everything. And I'll tell you right now, there's a lot of companies where even the owner of that company doesn't have full access to their data. We don't allow it, right? Because that person is the one that's is the highest risk. The person that thinks that they should have full access to everything, the ability to delete whatever they want. And they're probably also the ones going to open that zip file. They're the one that's going to go click on that thing they shouldn't on the website, get themselves infected, and lose all their data. So we don't. We just don't allow them to have that access. Now, if they say, I need access to this, sure, we'll give it to you. But we're going to try to talk you out of it. We're going to say, no, are you sure you want this type of a responsibility? Because if you encrypt all of your data, you know that means that you're not going to have... you're not going to have access to that data until a restore is done, right? Where we have to pull all the data from the backup, put it all back. You know, you're going to lose an entire day just because you wanted access to something. And so there needs to be a certain amount of, you got to look at data as it's valuable. It's a currency. And if you allow that information to get encrypted, if you are the source of the problem on your network, you should expect or you should ask that your access be taken away. So that way you don't harm your own business. And if you're an employee, the same type of thing, you know, applies. Do you really want to make it so that you can't work?
And I mean, that's we hold ourselves to that same standard, you know, in our company. There are areas of our network and our setups that nobody except Mike has access to, as right. It should be.
Yeah, and there's even some areas that, like, it's all compartmentalized, whereas, like, Winter has full access to areas that I don't.
Right.
Now, I mean, sure, I could go and seize that access if I wanted to, but it's designed in the event that something happens that it won't wipe out our entire digital existence. You know, so that everything is compartmentalized. User data is all separated so that if something terrible happens, you won't be able, nobody would be able to screw up like the backups that we do for people.
Yeah, no one person in the company can destroy everything.
Right. And that's exactly the way it should be. And so if you need help in your business or even in your home, making sure that your data is safe, then you should probably give us a call and let us help you out with that. Because there's really, it's so dangerous and it's so prevalent right now. The ransomware stuff has gone up many, many times as far as the how often it's happening. It used to be that we would see, you know, one or two a month, and now it's more like we get calls a couple times a day.
Yeah, we were just talking about this at the shop. You can actually go and buy unbranded ransomware now that you can then repackage as your own and distribute. It's like $400.
It has customer support even.
Yeah, yep.
They'll help you. I'm like, what?
They've got back ends like where you can encrypt and
manage
decrypt
it.
Yeah, exactly.
I think people are starting, you know, consumers to realize that data is the new oil. And he who has the data and the knowledge has the power.
Yeah. Well, I mean, for a long time, people were like, well, how do we get banking information? How do we get money directly from the client? And it turns out that it's way easier just to take something, to leverage them, to be like, okay, we've got your data. Now you have to willingly give us your money if you want your data back. And it turns out that that's a better plan than trying to get into the banks, because getting into the banks is kind of hard. I mean, it's not impossible, but there's definitely a level of difficulty there that does not exist when you're dealing with standard users or employees or people who don't understand that you shouldn't open zip files. Right? It's way easier, and especially the Macs. Right? Because you get somebody with a Mac. Now, the thing is that most Mac people have backups because Time Machine is so easy, and it's sort of built in. It's really easy to use. Interestingly enough, though, is that more than half of the people that get stuck with ransomware on Macs don't even consider their backup. They will pay the ransom. And there's a certain level of gullibility that is just ridiculous when it comes to the Mac users.
Now, maybe some of that is just overconfidence in the platform, because a lot of people still think that Macs can't get viruses.
Yeah, it is. It's absolutely about people feeling invincible, and then when it's illustrated or shown that they are not invincible, they panic and say, well, I have to get all my data back, so I'm just going to go ahead and pay the ransom.
And I mean, a lot of those ransomware set the ransom low enough that the most fiscally responsible thing to do is just pay their ransom. If the ransom's $100, you know?
Yeah, and I mean, most of them aren't that cheap.
Yeah, most of them, it's because they're so easily preventable nowadays. Most of those guys are trying to get like 4 Bitcoin, which is thousands of dollars.
And most people, I think that they're probably doing themselves a disservice by...
We had joked around at the shop about maybe we should buy one of these $400 packages and just charge like $10, because everybody would pay that.
No. That's not how the things work. I think that if they were going to be successful in that, though, that they would keep it very affordable and say, okay, here you go. But in the end, it's so easily preventable. It's not even difficult to prevent this type of failure. All you really have to do is have a couple little things in place to make sure that, one, you don't get it in the first place, all right? And that's most of its user education. Don't click on that. And then the other side of it is, there's a couple of pieces of software you can put on your machine to prevent those types of infections, unless you're on a Mac.
Nobody wants to get into a car accident, but everybody has car insurance, you know? Yeah.
And then the other side is the backups. Yeah, right? Between shadow copies, on-site backups, off-site backups, especially if you're a business, you should have all of those.
The off-site backups is important just in general. If your building burns down, your on-site backups aren't going to do anything.
If someone kicks your door in, which, you know, happens.
Yep.
And you can get your data back. Just be safe. Don't be so willy-nilly with your data. Come on now.
Willy-nilly.
If you decide to be willy-nilly with your data, always use protection.
That's right. Call Computer Guru. Yeah. We'll be right back.
Gonna go with that.
Whether you're dealing with hardware installation or, heaven forbid, a virus, Mike Swanson is answering all your questions one by one. So call in or chat in with yours. The website, guruShow.com. Tune in, click in, and kick back. This is the Computer Guru Show on AM 1030, KVOY The Voice.
I'm nerdy in the extreme and whiter than sour cream.
I was in AV club and glee club and even the chess team. Only question I ever thought was hard. What do I like, Kirk, or do I like Picard?
Spend every weekend at the Renaissance Fair. Got my name on my underwear. They see me strolling.
Welcome back to the Computer Guru Show, 790-2040 if you want to be part of the show. So in the last one we were talking about ransomware and that it's pretty easy to prevent. Just don't open the zip file. Don't click on the link. Just be careful.
And if you really are careful, you know, you'll be fine. I've realized several times that I've gone months without installing an antivirus. I just forgot. And as long as you practice those safe browsing practices, you know, you're not going to end up getting a virus anyway in most cases.
Yeah. I mean, on my machine, I don't have any antivirus.
That said, even with an antivirus, I personally in the past have gotten a rootkit that led to my eBay account getting used.
That's true. That's very true. There's another thing that you probably shouldn't do. Which is if you find a just, you know, some mysterious flash drive, USB flash drive in your mailbox, don't put it in your computer.
This blows my mind.
Yeah, so,
I figured it would.
Apparently in Australia, there are people just dropping baddie software on USB sticks, throwing them in mailboxes and hoping that people put them in their machines.
Now, I like to check out a random flash drive just as much as the next guy. Okay. But us responsible people have bootable Linux disks for that.
That's right. We have either appropriate sandboxes or we have some type of PE device to boot into.
I get it. I get the urge to just, you know, just see what's on that drive, but just
Linux Live CDs, by the way, they're like gold.
You know, I remember when I was a kid and I was in school in my networking class, seeing my networking teacher use a Linux bootable CD, and I'd never seen one before. And I was just like, what is this magical instant fix thing?
What kind of sorcery is this? Yeah, if you're going to inspect a rogue USB drive that you find in your mailbox, you should probably just have some type of, you know, live CD that you can boot off of first to take a look at it. But you should probably just report it. Like if you're in the US, you probably just want to, you know, hey FBI, hey, check this out.
So RT in the chat says that we should define what we consider safe browsing practices.
Well, don't click on stuff you shouldn't. Basically, it really comes down to use the right browser. The Internet Explorer is not safe browsing practices. If you're using Internet Explorer, it's no.
I mean, how commonly is malware distributed through ads these days?
Well, it depends on what sites you're going to. And I think that there's a fair amount. There's enough of it happening that you should be concerned about it and use some type of a decent ad blocker.
As far as I know, cannot do with something like Internet Explorer.
You cannot do with Internet Explorer, not effectively. Yeah. There are a couple of kind of clone-like ad blockers out there. But as far as keeping your browser safe, nope.
I mean, I mentioned before the whole don't click the giant green button thing, but that really, click the giant green button.
Don't click the download link. At least not the first one you see. You should make sure you know what you're clicking on.
There's been times where I couldn't find a download link for something because it was a big green button, and my mind just edits those out.
You can't see them at all. Yeah, so you should be using one of the, like we like Chrome. So the examples I'm going to give are Chrome-based, which is use a decent browser, so either Firefox or Chrome. But, you know,
Whoa. You
guys know how I feel about Firefox. And then have a decent ad blocker on there. Right now we're saying uBlock Origin. And make sure that all of the advertising is gone.
Also, shout out to Vivaldi Browser, because that's a new one and it's pretty cool.
I haven't played with that one yet.
I use it at the shop occasionally. I really like to use it for testing websites, because it's got some tools that are good for that. But it's a nice little browser. So it's basically Opera. After Opera got sold, the Opera team went and built Vivaldi.
All right. And really, it's just sort of paying attention to what you're doing, right? And part of that comes down to making sure that when you install other software, like if you install Java or something like that, that you're not allowing it to install any search hooks, that you're not allowing it to redirect your browser.
Yeah, don't just hammer through that next button. Actually read those things.
Right. Like if you look in your ad remove programs list and you have coupon printer and the ask toolbar or any of that stuff in your add remove programs list, you've not been browsing properly. That is not safe browsing. It's definitely not safe installing practices. You know, that stuff should not be on your computer. And if it is, you did it wrong.
Yeah, I was kind of thinking maybe we should call it defensive browsing, like how they call it defensive driving.
Well, there's a certain amount of that. And it's really hard to explain, at least from my perspective, just because I've been doing this for so long that when I look at, just like you were saying, you just filter out that stuff. I literally do not see the ads.
Kevin in the chat says purchase Malwarebytes. Yep, because you get that active scanning.
Yeah, the paid version of Malwarebytes is one of the only softwares that we say that everyone should have. Right? You know, if you're a Mac, they don't have a paid version. They only have the free version. But if you're on a PC, the paid version of Malwarebytes is like the only paid mandatory software.
And it's for the active scanning, right? That's what you really want.
You want the active scanning. And it also prevents most of the CryptoLocker type infections. So, I mean, whether or not it's just because the chat mentioned this, whether or not the CryptoWare is building a wall around your data or stealing it in other ways, the Malwarebytes will help to prevent that to a certain extent.
Now, it's like only, what, $30 a year or something?
$30 a year for 3 computers.
That's pretty good.
So it's not bad. And I think it's a pretty small investment to have that extra layer of security on there and keep you a bit safer. Yeah, I mean, nothing's 100%. Nothing's going to stop everything. Nothing is going to make it so that you are invulnerable to these types of attacks. Nothing's going to turn it into a Mac. Just kidding. That's a joke.
That Linux bootable CD might make you pretty invulnerable.
Yeah, well, the Linux boot CD will make you easily recoverable. So if you boot off the live CD every day, then every time you reboot your computer, it's all back to normal again.
Come at me, bro. I'm behind 7 Linuxes.
No, that's not how this works. But anyway, if you find any USB drives in your mailbox.
Come on, guys. Don't be doing
don't
that.
Click.
Don't
click.
You don't know where it's been. Don't stick that thing in there.
So I'm stuck on this. So picture this, Mike. Picture this. You go out to your mailbox. You find a stick. You come back in. You set it on your kitchen table. And you spend the next 45 minutes just staring at it. I wonder what's on there. I don't know. What do you think? I don't know. What should we do?
I don't know that I would be that curious. I really wouldn't. Like, if I were to find one, first of all, you know, I have Linux boot CDs just laying around. I'd just fire one up and be like, okay, let's...
I don't know. I've seen too many movies where, like, the main character is a normal dude who gets wrapped into a spy mystery because he picked up a random CD or flash drive or something.
Right.
I don't want Shia LaBeouf involved in my life in any way, so.
Shia LaBeouf.
Nice. Oh, man. Let's go ahead and take a break. When we come back from the break, we'll see if we can help you out with more information and technology to help keep you...
from clicking those green buttons.
Yeah, don't click the green button. We'll be right back.
Computer troubles? Need some advice? Call in now. Mike Swanson will be back after these messages. The Computer Guru Show, AM 1030, KVOY, The Voice. Mike Swanson, your computer guru, is just a click away. Listen and watch at guruShow.com. This is The Computer Guru Show on KVOY, The Voice.
Welcome back to the show. Let's see, last segment of the first hour.
Yay. First segment of the last hour?
No.
Last segment
of the first hour.
Gotcha.
Yeah. Don't get it twisted.
Mike gets more gangster every episode.
That's right. All right. So what are they saying? The iPhone 7 is now catching a fire?
Yes, they are certainly saying
that. Is that what they are saying?
You know, I really don't like when people make me defend things that I don't like.
Okay. But defend it.
iPhone 7s are not exploding. A normal amount of them have exploded, just like with every phone.
Now, I don't think that people realize that every model of every phone has burst into flames at one point or another.
When you sell, you know, literally millions of a device, some of them are going to have some catastrophic problems.
Right, and tens of millions in most cases.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, like I was saying on the way over here, if this is the only one that exploded, I'm sure Apple's pretty happy.
I think the reason it's getting attention is because of the Note 7 and then the poor Samsung washer dryers.
Well, yeah. I mean, if, I think everybody just wants to get in on the exploding phone thing.
Yeah, it's
but,
hot.
You know, if they were paying attention, they would know that every time a phone is released, some of them explode.
Did you hear what she just said?
I did, but I ignored it.
I didn't mean it like that, actually. I was thinking, like, it's a hot news item.
Yeah. Samsung just needs to start making fire extinguishers. Samsung brand fire extinguishers.
Those look slim, you know, too.
I feel onboard really, halons.
I feel really bad for Samsung in this whole thing.
Have you seen...
Just bad luck.
Have you seen... I think it's the IT crowd. And he's got the fire extinguisher, and it's on fire. And he's like, I'm just going to put this in the fire pile.
That's right. It's IT crowd, by the way, great show. If you ever have an opportunity to see it, it sort of explains...
Us
nerdy lives.
You know,
in general.
I'm looking at this this Yahoo tech article about the exploding iPhone. When you're quoting Reddit as a source of your news, like not just Reddit, but a Reddit user, come on, man, that's lazy journalism.
You're so triggered.
Let's talk about batteries for a second. Any battery that you just find a battery and pick it up. Just any battery. There is a warning on that battery.
If you find a battery, probably don't pick it up for this exact reason.
All batteries have an inherent fire danger. Do we not understand how releases of energy work?
Well, look at with the e-cigarette thing. You know, those batteries were exploding. There was a whole big thing about
that. Yeah, there's all kinds of people who have had their face explode, right, because of these e-cigarette vapor things. Maybe their face didn't explode, but
that would be pretty bad press for whatever company.
It's happened. Somebody had one of those. They were actively using the device, and it exploded.
And so their face exploded.
Their face was rather. We'll just say
singed. Is there a video?
They were
of this?
Singed.
I actually would like
to see that. They were a little cooked, but the batteries are dangerous. Especially the high output batteries, like the lithium batteries.
Yeah, I mean, everybody always wants a bigger battery in your phone. It's like, it's going to be a thermonuclear device at some point.
Well, you have to think about it. If they're making that much energy, I mean, it's a huge amount of energy that is in very, very small space. It's dangerous.
We've seen a cell phone battery pop at the shop before. It's not pretty.
I've made a bunch of batteries explode before. The ones I use for when I used to do remote control airplanes. Those were some serious batteries. And there's been a couple of them that I have had in-flight fires, right? Where you're just flying around and the plane bursts into flames. The batteries are dangerous. And if it comes down to the fact that you have a phone that catches on the fire, yeah, you're doing better than average, because there's probably at least one of these a week.
So I doubt that the iPhone 7 is having anywhere near the same volume of exploding phones that the Note 7 was.
Well, as far as I know, there hasn't been any government-related safety issues, you know, where they're saying you must return this phone immediately.
Yeah, I mean that wasn't the whole Note 7 thing. Wasn't just your average, you know, recall. It was an advanced recall. The government was like, you need to return your phone.
Right now. Was there somebody that was at the shop that...
Yeah, Becky still has it. Because you can't get them yet, you know, you can't get the new ones yet.
Well, according to Verizon, you can now.
Well, when she went in there, I guess over the weekend, she was told that they were fresh out.
Fresh out.
But they were like, we can get you into this other phone that doesn't explode for the moment, and then you can come back. And she was like, no.
Really?
Yeah.
All right, so let's just go ahead and say that if you have a note, the new note,
take note.
You should probably, and this isn't even a probably. You are being told that the safe thing to do to keep your personal self, yourself safe, and all of your possessions, if you happen to be charging your phone, I don't know, in your house or in your car, that you should probably get rid of it. Take that phone down and take the supplemental replacement if that's what they've got available, or get it replaced. Or call Verizon instead of going to the store and say, I need you to ship me a phone. And they will.
I think Becky was getting a notice on her phone like every 20 minutes saying, you need to return this.
Yeah, and they said they're going to get worse until the point, because Samsung is telling you, you have this phone that needs to be returned. And from what I understand... This weekend, as of the first, it will completely disable the phone.
Well, I know that there was some question about that, if the legality involved in actually just disabling the phone.
You'll still be able to make calls, but they're, from what I understand, they're turning off all of the other features on the phone to tell you.
Well, I mean, I guess technically speaking, they're allowed to push whatever update they want to the phone.
Yeah, and especially when you've got a recall action here.
Yeah.
Right? If this were just a, I'm using my phone that doesn't have any other problems and Samsung is trying to force me to get a new phone for free, then that would be a different story.
They uncovered our marketing scheme.
Yeah, their idea is, well, you know, we just want you to get a new phone for free.
They're trying out loss leaders, you know. They're like, any press is good press.
Right. We're going to spend $1 billion.
Let's get that Samsung name out there.
Seriously, $1 billion lost on these phones. Yeah, go get your new phone and try not to put yourself at risk. It's dangerous. Come on now.
Yeah, I don't want to. It makes me nervous that Becky's like near me when she has that phone.
All right, so it's the takeaway from the first hour of the show here, right? Don't click on the things you shouldn't be clicking on. Don't have that phone in your pocket if you shouldn't still own it. And have some sort of ad blocker on your browser, and don't use Internet Explorer. That's the takeaway from the first hour.
Definitely don't use Internet Explorer.
Yeah, additionally, on the whole safe browsing practices, by the way, there's a certain amount of just be skeptical. Don't realize that everything that you click on potentially could expose your data to the world. You could set yourself up for an identity theft. You could lose all of your data.
I could just imagine somebody out there hearing this and just panicking. They're like, they're trying to hack me right now.
And just
think of it like snake oil.
Everything is dangerous. Right? Everything, like,
don't go outside of your house. No. Everything is dangerous.
It's not like that, but like when you go to the gas station. All right, you ride the bus, so I'm not going to talk to you. But
I have a car, Mike.
I know, but you don't use it.
I do use it.
Oh, okay. So when you go to the gas station, do you check to make sure to make sure that the credit card reader hasn't been tampered with and all of that? It's the same type of thing like when you go to a website. You should be looking for clues that somebody wants to do something not so friendly.
And eventually you'll just develop like a spider sense when it comes to these things, and you'll be able to tell when something is, you know, not trustworthy just by looking at it.
Yeah. Yeah, okay. Let's go ahead and throw Phil on here before we run out of time. Hey, Phil, how are you doing?
Not bad. I was going to say that these guys are trying to lessen their liability on this. I mean, there's a bunch of people who are just too stupid to turn them in.
What are you talking about?
They're
going to
be injured on the phones.
Yeah, okay.
And they're going to get injured, and, you know, the amount of money is going to depend on how much Samsung does to, you know, remediate this.
Well, I've thought about it like the people who are warned that there's going to be a tornado and they just don't leave their house. You know, it's like, well, we did our best to warn you.
Yeah.
That's right. Well, they told them all that down there in, when they had that hurricane in Katrina come in, get out of town, and they all stuck around just to see what happened so they could go loot stores, and some of them got in trouble.
I don't know that that was probably the overall intent, but, you know, hey, we can go with that.
A lot of people for years have loved to be able to loot after a hurricane. That's just part of the aftermath.
That's a different show, Phil. It really is.
I understand. But the idea that they're trying to, you know, lessen their amount of money they have to spend.
Yeah, so
they're doing it as nicely as they can.
I definitely blame them for trying to lessen it on themselves.
Yeah, and not to mention, it is the responsible thing to do, right? Get rid of the phone. Thanks for the call, Phil.
Why would you want that in your pocket with your leg?
No kidding, man.
All right, so stick around for the second hour of the Computer Guru Show. If you'd like to be part of the show, 790-2040. We'll be back after these messages. Welcome back to the Computer Guru Show. Hour number two, 790-2040. If you want to be part of the show, it's 520-790-2040. We'll see if we can do to help you out with whatever technology issues you have while treating you like a person in the process.
And that's what we do.
It's what we do. So apparently there's a bunch of angry Pokemon Go players.
There's a lot of angry ex-Pokemon Go players. I know that because I'm one of them.
Right? All right. So why are you angry, man?
Well, I've been an ex-Pokemon Go player for a while.
Really?
Because they lied about their game.
How did they lie?
Well, Tara knows. They took away the ability to actually do what the game's supposed to do.
To actually go hunt down the Pokemon?
Yeah, you can't hunt them down anymore. And then they killed all the third-party, you know, tools that people built that allowed you to do it as well.
Right.
So, it's like if I wanted to sit in my house and play Pokemon, I would just do it with, like, one of the old Pokemon games.
Okay. All right. And so this was enough to make you say, I'm not playing this game anymore.
Yep. Uninstalled.
Uninstalled. How about you? Did you ever play? You played it. But you can't really well, where you live.
No. However, I did take some trips downtown to actually play and still couldn't play.
Really? So that little, like, you know, step finder thing.
Oh, yeah, that's gone.
That's important.
That's the whole purpose in the game.
The whole reason is, oh, okay, there's a Pokemon nearby. But if you don't know if there's any Pokemon nearby...
It could be, you know, a six-block radius.
Yeah, and it could be north, south, east, west, or anywhere in between.
Interesting. So now, I know that Pokemon Go has been saying... Niantic has been saying, well, we're going to fix this. We're gonna make this work. But do you think it's too late?
Any minute now. I mean, maybe. I might check it out again if they were to fix that in the future, but I certainly wouldn't ever consider putting money into the game.
I'm going
to
answer your question with a question. Have they fixed any of the stuff with Ingress?
Same company, so.
Yeah, that's true.
They haven't. They don't tend to listen to their community. They're doing better with it because it's Pokemon.
Right, because they've got a lot more attention on them.
Right,
now.
But aside from that, yeah, no.
Well, big news for them was that they hired a community liaison.
Yeah. Yeah. The thing is, though, Pokemon Go, it's the latest in a string of angry gamer episode type things.
Okay.
Pokemon Go is not it's the latest game to get the ire up of gamers because there's a lot of games and it's kind of a go-to now that don't deliver on their promises. They over-promise way before the game is released. They either delay the release or when the game comes out, it's really buggy and unplayable.
This is kind of what I was alluding to earlier when I was talking about how you should be able to demo a game instead of a paid beta. Especially on Steam with the whole early access thing, you're paying for a game that might only be like a tenth of the way built.
And may never be built.
Yeah, and like there's games that I play and I've purchased them in early access years ago and they're still in early access.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm like, by the time you release this game, no one's going to care. You know, you've already captured the market you were going to capture. So,
I guess it's one of the reasons I don't really play video games. Yeah, I have a few that I like, but most of the stuff I play is like puzzle games.
No Man's Sky is another one that's recently come under fire for pretty much the same thing.
Well, they were saying that they're under investigation now from the advertising board, National Advertising Board, because they feel it was misrepresented.
And it was.
It definitely was. And this is a game that a lot of people pre-ordered because they were just shown footage that wasn't even the game that was released.
Yeah.
So it's not like they thought or they were being led to believe something that wasn't true. They were seeing gameplay. It just turned out that was a totally separate build that the public doesn't get.
Yeah, you don't get to see that.
With
you
all
didn't
kinds
get to
of spaceships and the animals and creatures on the planets were actually doing more sentient things than right now. They're just kind of flopping around on the planets.
Really trying to say that it wasn't a bait and switch tactic, that just there were problems and, you know, they had to make exceptions for the actual public release. But it's just so many aspects, like nearly every aspect of the game is different than what it was claimed to be.
Is it not unheard of to delay a release because of problems?
Well, apparently, I mean, didn't No Man's Sky get delayed once?
A couple times.
Okay.
And the thing is, most gamers are okay with a delay. They are okay with a delay.
Because it's like an everyday practice.
If the game comes out and you get your game that you thought it was.
I kind of think, though, that this is just the inevitable result of game development being more accessible. Because it's on Steam, you can be just a person, just one person, not even a company. And you can develop a game yourself and release it.
Right.
And to the user, because they don't see that you're just one person, it looks like it's a studio developing it, you know? So the expectations are, like, way higher.
Right, and that's sort of bridging the gap between the one-person app development, like Flappy Bird, you know, to a larger... I mean, don't get me wrong, the No Man's Sky is ambitious. And they are a very small group that's putting that together.
I think the ambitious aspects of the game are the problem, though. It's because they just didn't set realistic expectations for their small team. Like, what they wanted to do would have been a big effort for any major studio.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the major studios can't put out decent games anyway.
For the most part. I think that the major studios just don't want to take the risks that a smaller development company will take, and that cuts both ways. Sometimes really good games come out of small studios, and then, you know, you get AAA games like the Doom game, which was just bland.
You know? Right, right. And even the relaunch of Duke Nukem.
Yeah, that's a great example.
Which was, you know, highly anticipated because of the amount of time that it
14 years or something, yeah.
And then it turning out to be just a terrible, terrible game.
Actually, it wasn't that bad.
I didn't think it was bad, but
I think people had their expectations way too high because it took so long. But it was Duke Nukem. Come on.
It was an alright game. Nukem. I mean, it was fun. It wasn't worth $60 or whatever, but...
I guess that's the part that bothers me the most is that, you know, like, even if I did have the... Oh, come on now, it's Duke Nukem.
Yeah.
Right? Which I probably should have had when I took a look at that game. It's $60.
I think I disagree, though. I think Fallout 4 was totally worth it. You know, Skyrim was worth $60.
I think there are games worth it. But when that's the standard is $60, I went to a store recently and saw a game that we had bought in, like, early access, and it's like $40 for the console, and I'm like, why? It's not that great.
Now, on that same token, if I pay $10 for an early access game, whatever. I don't care if it's not completed or it's not, you know,
Well, that's the part I'm trying to get at, is that there's a certain amount of, you know, if you have to invest in that game a larger dollar amount, you're going to hope that it's worth that dollar amount. So if you put $10 into a game and it's buggy or whatever, and eventually gets better, then, you know, your investment in it is like, yeah, well, I was there in the beginning. I got to see the bugs get fixed. I feel better about this game versus, you know, dropping $60 to $100 on a game and having it be just not worth the $10 you should have paid in early access.
That was exactly the case with No Man's Sky, because they did charge $60 for that game. And it was, you know, this is why people were angry. If they had paid $10 for it, people would have been like, meh, it's $10. I got a couple hours out of it.
Right. It wouldn't have been worth the lawsuit.
Right. But now a $60 game that was sold to millions of people and just was not even close to what they were advertising it as, they're literally being investigated for bad advertising practices.
Yeah. Well, I think they deserve it in this case.
Yeah, and actually, it's funny that we were talking about Pokemon Go that started this whole conversation, because I think they should be next.
And it sounds like they are. They're getting all kinds of complaints
now
from the federal government about that.
Just
game.
Like we were just saying, though, Pokemon Go is free. You don't have to put any money into it.
Right.
So I wasn't really that upset. I was like, oh, I wanted to play it, but I didn't invest any money, not a single penny. So to me, it's not a big deal.
Right. I think that if especially if Pokemon Go were a played game or a paid game, right, the outrage would be.
Now, there are definitely people out there who have put hundreds of dollars into Pokemon Go.
One of the people suing, actually, had put $450 into Pokemon Go, which I think is personally insane.
Yeah.
But that was his thing. He wanted to play Pokemon Go, so he did, and he put money into
it. Sort of like a financial Darwinism.
And his lawsuit is basically they banned his account because he had used a third-party system, and they didn't give him any forewarning or anything, so they banned him.
What do you mean forewarning? They said don't use third-party systems.
It's true.
There's some elusive wording in the.
I think that he has
contracts.
Like, you know, I was gonna say that I think he has a case, but in reality, I just agree with him because, yeah, I understand being upset. They nerfed the entire point of that game, and so in order to recover the ability to play the game, he used a third-party system. However, if they say don't do that, that's on you, man.
But he's asking, like, his lawsuit is actually pretty low-key. All he's asking is either, you know, I'm going to sue you and you give me money, or just give me my account back. I just want to play. That's really all it is for him.
That's probably what'll end up happening, too, is they'll just unban him.
I mean, the guy did spend $450. That's a lot.
Then again, you know, you break the terms of service. Like, that's what happens.
Yeah, just because he paid money doesn't mean that he gets to break the rules.
And actually, if he did get unbanned specifically because he paid money, that would make me want to play this game even less.
Yeah, that's a lack of integrity on Niantic's part.
Well, there's a lot of lacks of integrity on their part, but, you know.
Oh, my goodness. Yeah, let's have some integrity and a break. Let's do that. Start some music there, Kent. Let's go. Come on, man. Hit some buttons.
Any of you guys out there play games? Call us up on the next segment.
I'd like to know what people think. 790-2040 if you want to be part of the show. Be right back. The words will make you out.
Your computer guru, Mike Swanson, is here to help you tame that beast of a machine. Join the chat right now at guruShow.com or call in. This is the Computer Guru Show on KVOY, The Voice. And is answering all your questions one by one.
Yes, science!
So chime in with yours. The website is guruShow.com. Tune in, click in, and kick back. This is the Computer Guru Show.
I guess we should put our headphones on and be ready to go here. Okay, welcome back to the show. 790-2040 if you want to be part of the show. Let's talk about wearables for a second.
Normally I like wearables.
I don't actually think that this is such a bad idea, but Snapchat is putting out sunglasses.
Well, and they're no longer Snapchat either.
What?
They changed their name to Snap Inc. because of the glasses.
What?
What?
Did they really?
Yes.
So they're
no longer Snapchat.
All on board with these glasses then.
Yeah.
Oh, interesting. Well, they're releasing some glasses and they're calling them spectacles, which I guess is...
That's sort of clever.
Yeah, sort of.
I'll give them that.
And they will be priced at $130, $129.99. And basically, they have a camera built into them. And the upside is they sort of look like normal
sunglasses. Yeah, it's not like Google Glass where you look like a cyborg walking around.
Where you look like somebody who just needed to be punched in the face, like with Google Glass. These look like sort of normal sunglasses. And you can hit a button on the side and it posts to Snapchat.
Does it say what the...
Or Snap Inc. or whatever they're called these days.
Snap Inc.
Does it give any info about the camera?
Yeah, well, the camera is... by the way, 10-second intervals. That's it. That's all you get because, you know...
Well, that's how Snapchat works, right?
Right. So you don't have to worry about people recording your whole life unless they're...
In 10-second intervals, they will.
Tara's pointing at the screen where it says that they're changing their name to Snap Inc., which... Why?
I think they should have just kept it Snapchat.
He'll always be Snoop Dogg. It'll always be Snapchat.
Yeah, and it'll always be Google instead of Alphabet.
Yeah, I always forget that even happened.
Yeah, nobody cares. What are you gonna do? You're gonna Alphabet go Alphabet that.
They're like, we're changing our name for tax fraud. I mean, tax purposes.
So anyway, it's a camera built into some sunglasses that allow you to post things to Snapchat. Now.
Yeah, whatever. That's cool, I guess.
I kind of look at these things like I look at most things when it comes to technology and social media and such, which is great. This just makes it easier for people to, A, wear sunglasses indoors and look like a dork, and then, secondly, take pictures of their food. And it just bothers me. See? Yeah? Look at Rob right now. Do you see what it... Yeah, dork. as far as people... I've never really understood Snapchat to begin with, and I'm sure that I'll get some hate for that.
Well, from what I can see, the thing I don't like about these is that when Snapchat inevitably fails at some point in the future, there's just going to be all this hardware that doesn't do anything now.
I'm sure that somebody will hack these glasses and make it useful for something else. But
they also, you know, this article started out by saying that they're very expensive. They're really not. $130.
Well, compared,
I pay less for my prescription glasses.
Compared to Google Glass, which was $1,500.
That's what I mean. Like, I went into this thinking they were going to be, like, Google Glass expensive.
Right.
But then again, they're nowhere near as useful either, so.
Well, there is that.
Yeah. Oh, man. I wonder how many people have bought these already.
I bet they're going to be pretty popular on the college campuses.
Granted, Ray-Bans cost $200 to $300.
Yeah, but Ray-Bans are nice.
But they're just sunglasses, is my point.
Well, yeah, I mean, it's just like how I was talking about those, the new iPhone headphones.
Right.
If the glasses themselves are nice and good, like this picture here, if they all look like that, then never mind. But if, you know, if they make different styles and some of them look nice, I don't know, that might be all right.
Yeah.
People spend like $400 on sunglasses already.
This is true. And then they immediately lose them.
Yeah, I saw a guy break his $300 Gucci sunglasses, and I just laughed.
Don't laugh.
It's like you could have bought 30 pairs of $10 sunglasses.
You can't even get $10 sunglasses anymore. Even the ones that are terrible are like $30 in the store now.
That's
terrible.
You don't shop where I shop.
I buy mine online, honestly.
Yeah?
Huh? Dollar store.
Yeah, there you go.
Mm-hmm. Favorite store.
All right, so... You guys know I don't go to Walmart, right?
Yeah.
I also don't go to dollar stores.
You're missing out, bro.
You should. There's some good
stuff. Like, the base price for anything I buy needs to be $50.
No, that's not the case. It's just that I can't. It's like, it's the same reason I don't go to Circle K, right? It's just like.
The inconvenience store, you mean?
Yeah, it's why? I should have my own little, like, a segment of the show just called the Mike Rants About Convenience Stores.
Mike the upscale hipster.
I am not an upscale hipster. Wasn't it you that was telling me that you went to the Circle K by the shop and that you had somebody hitting you up for change in the store?
At the counter when I was paying for my stuff. And I was like, now I can't even lie to you and say I don't have change. So I was just like, I do have change, but I want all of this. Sorry.
Oh, man.
I'm a terrible person.
Circle K should, like, I don't know, man.
If QT did a Kickstarter to just, like, open up more stores, I would fund that one.
So is that what it is, Mike? It's not the actual store. It's the people that you would have to interact with.
There's a certain level of interaction that I don't want to have with humans.
Yeah. To be fair, that's the same reason why I try to buy things online as much as I can.
Yeah, I get you.
I hear you, man.
Come on, man. And, you know, I don't necessarily want to be mugged at the gas pump. So.
It's like 50.
Hey, have you seen prices today? We're already getting mugged.
Oh, my God.
Yeah, it's just. I don't know. I already have to worry about, you know, is this pump safe for my credit card, right? Has it been compromised in some way? And then there's three dudes walking around behind me, and I'm like, what do you want? And, it shouldn't be that uncomfortable.
About Tree Fitty. That's what they want.
Yeah, it shouldn't be that uncomfortable just to get fuel. That's what I'm saying. Got to go to Costco. There's nobody walking around.
Costco is like the greatest store of all time.
What do you mean
though,
nobody walking around? There's always
no, at
Costco.
The fuel pumps.
That's true.
It's because they all got ran over.
Well, you have to. You get like Costco membership checked just to get in there.
Yeah.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's right. This is an exclusive club, sir.
You must be able to at least afford a $50 membership to even come in here.
All right then, Costco it is. So, anyways, the Snapchat glasses. I just don't understand Snapchat. I just don't get it, right? I've even tried because my niece is really into Snapchat, and I try to be the cool uncle.
Does it make you confused and angry?
No, not angry. I'm like, come on now, what?
Would you say that as a parent, you just don't understand?
Oh, good.
So I feel similarly about Snapchat as I did to Instagram when it came down to it. It's just like, it's just food, or it's... It's stuff that nobody really needs to know about or nobody cares about.
Well, everybody wants to think that they're on their own little private stage.
I guess, but you are not the main central character of the universe here.
Hey, speak for yourself, buddy.
Fine. We'll let you be the central character of the universe. Only during the break, though.
I can deal with that.
All right. Let's do it, Kent. Start some music. Come on now. I know, I'm early.
You're early. What's up with that?
I have a plan.
Hey, it's our show. Take breaks when we want to.
Yeah, it's my show. I'll break now. That's right. We'll be right back.
Whether you're dealing with hardware installation or, heaven forbid, a virus,
No!
Mike Swanson is answering all your questions one by one. So call in or chat in with yours. The website, guruShow.com. Tune in, click in, and kick back. This is the Computer Guru Show on AM 1030, KVOY The Voice.
Welcome back to the Computer Guru Show. Let's talk about Windows updates now because...
They fail.
They are failing continually these days. And the thing is that Windows 10 has made it a little more difficult to make the updates less failure-prone. You can't turn them off very easily. And if you do, it has other adverse effects on the usability of the machine.
Well, yeah, you need your updates.
And it's making it hard, Microsoft, for me to tell people to get their updates because updates are important. But when you go breaking people's machines every 2 weeks, I would suggest that maybe you got to get some QA on that. Maybe a little quality control.
So it says that it's causing machines to restart multiple times as they try to remove the update.
Yeah, and now we've had mixed results at the shop. Apparently, if you just let it sit for a long time, it'll eventually fix itself.
So is this like on Windows 7 where if the update just didn't go right for some reason, it would try to roll it back?
I think it's similar, but I think it's instead of it actually being able to get into Windows, it just says, nah, we can't do that. Nah.
So before the OS even loads.
Fail. Come on, Microsoft.
You're better than this, Microsoft.
So if you're under the GPS services, the managed services, I have the Microsoft updates set to download on Tuesday and then install on Sunday.
So that there's time to check if it's going to be a fail.
Right, so that if Microsoft decides to push a fix, then it will fix them and then get the new updates before. But tell Windows not to install automatically and wait a while. But the thing is that Windows 10 complains a lot if you don't get your updates. It like pops up screens the whole time. It's very irritating. I need a pop-up blocker from Microsoft.
Yeah, I think we should actually give a lesson on how to disable Windows system sounds because they get pretty obnoxious on Windows 10.
Yeah, we'll put out a video tutorial. How's that?
It's a good idea.
All right, it's just, oh man, come on, Microsoft, you're killing me, Smalls. It's just, stop it.
You don't even have the energy to rant about Windows anymore.
The whole Windows 10 thing. It must be a completely different department in charge of the whole Windows 10 upgrade and Windows updates, right? As far as the rest of the company is concerned, because on everything else, it's like they don't bother you at all. In fact, they don't even tell you stuff they should tell you when it comes to. but when it comes to the Windows 10 upgrades / Windows updates now, it's like it's so in your face, it's exhausting. Just stop it.
Yeah, I've had antiviruses that were less in your face than Windows 10 is.
Right, and like Panda Antivirus.
Yep.
Right, which popped up every 40 minutes or something. Is like, hey, you know you're using the free version? That's sort of what I feel like. If I had the free version of Windows, sure, I'll accept that. If I didn't have to pay...
Don't give them any ideas. Free Windows with ad support.
Every day I feel more like, you know what? It's a Linux world, man. It's
Except coming. Ubuntu did the ad thing already.
Not them. It's every Linux except for the ones that give you ads.
Yeah, and there's the good thing about Linux is that there's pretty much anything you want. There's a Linux out there for that.
Yeah, Howard says he's very happy with Nopix recently.
Oh yeah, he's been showing me some of the features. He was like, oh, this says it's the best data recovery Linux image. So let's try it out. And then 10 minutes later, he's like, this is the best data recovery Linux image.
I concur.
We were just losing our minds about the cool screensavers that it has, honestly.
Really? I didn't see any of them.
It had a bunch of cool ones, where it would solve a really complex maze, you know?
I don't think I've been impressed by a screensaver since the 90s.
You mean the flying toaster one? I too was impressed.
No, the ribbons.
Well, this one, it had an endless supply of cool screensavers.
Okay, then. Well, I mean, if that's what you need to, if that floats your boat, man.
Howard was just happy because it didn't make him write a bunch of Linux commands. It just popped up and was like, do you want us to automatically do this for you? He was like, yes, that's all I've ever wanted.
Howard, I just want to let you know, that's lazy. Just lazy.
You should have to assemble your own Linux image every time.
If you're not compiling your own kernel every time, no, you're doing it wrong. No, I'm just kidding, guys. Easier is better when it comes to the Linux stuff. So, and I think that that's probably where we're going to end up going, is that I've been working on pushing all of the servers over to Linux builds. And like I said, I'm still working on trying to get a workstation build that is usable.
I think that I could use Linux at home for the most part because I don't, these days I don't play a huge amount of games like I used to.
Right.
But I definitely couldn't use it at work yet.
Yeah, I'm so done with, there's a fatigue when it comes to the updates and things being broken. And I totally get why people are just like, you know what? I'm switching to Mac. You know, it unfortunately they get themselves into trouble with that too. But
yep.
You know, there's a certain amount of, I'm tired of having to give a bunch of money to these companies that aren't providing a stable solution for me to just do my job.
You know, I would actually be okay with if Linux took like the WordPress approach to, or excuse me, if Windows took like the WordPress approach, which is just building a really good core system with almost no features. And right. then letting people just extend it as they want
to. That's sort of what the Linux system is.
Exactly, yeah.
As it's, here is the base. This is what you get. And if you want to make it your own, go for it. You just add anything that you want at your own risk. And that's not a bad way to deal with things.
There's definitely been times where I see a utility for Windows, and I'm like, man, Microsoft should just buy those guys and incorporate that.
Yeah, the thing is they'll probably do... like what they did with there was an open source document sharing application that you could put on a website in your own web server, and you could have people do collaborative document editing, much like Google Docs. And then Microsoft bought them because it was competing with SharePoint, and they just killed the product. That's like, come on.
I mean, just the same thing that they did with the Edge browser. Like, rather than just embrace all these open source technologies for rendering the web that are out there, they're like, nope, we're going to build our own. And it's terrible.
It's not great. I have to admit that Edge is better than the older versions of Internet Explorer. But as far as it sort of works.
I tried out that the whole paid to browse Edge thing, by the way.
Let me ask you something. If the goal that the bar you set for yourself is, well, at least it doesn't suck as much as the last one, is that not the greatest? I think that you could probably reach a little bit higher. You're Microsoft.
I definitely think that Edge inherited just some of the hatred for Internet Explorer, and maybe unnecessarily, because it's not Internet Explorer.
No, it's not.
But the fact that it's like, hey, you should really use Bing, you know, nonstop. I'm just like, come on, stop trying to make Bing happen.
Or the Microsoft. Why is the address bar invisible?
Or why does it move around when you click it?
It's just
why.
Yeah, I think that if the bar that you've set for yourself, if you are a software company, and not to mention, I mean, not just any run-of-the-mill, I started up 3 weeks ago software company. I'm talking about a company that's been around for 30-plus years and that knows how to write software. I mean, theoretically.
Right.
It knows how to write software. Why is the bar that is set... well, it's not the worst thing we've ever written.
The sad thing is, like we were talking about Vivaldi, I mean, they basically started 3 weeks ago. You know, like, they're a brand new browser, and it's already far better than Edge. I guess it's like you said, man, the bar is invisible.
Yeah, and like even Chrome, right, which has its problems, right? You can't say that Chrome is a perfect product by any stretch of the imagination. Google is not an application developer. They do search engines. That's it as their primary product. They don't really make desktop applications, but they have a browser that works on literally every platform and works the same way
on all of them. The main difference is that Google doesn't isolate themselves and think that, you know, there's no customer feedback ever. Microsoft seems to just ignore what their users say, whereas Google's like, hey, that's a good idea.
I'm just trying to say, you know, set the bar, Microsoft, come on, set the bar higher than, well, it doesn't suck
I don't know,
that much.
I don't know if at this point they'll ever have a good browser, though.
Well, they should just give up the browser market altogether.
Just do what you do, Microsoft.
All right. In fact, the browser that comes with the machine, I understand that they have to have a browser that comes with the machine. And they don't want to play favorites like they did with, you know, like Netscape Navigator back in the day. All right, so why not just have a browser that only, I mean, it doesn't do anything but get you to a very specific set of sites. Like, the websites that would be visible in that have to be coded in such a way that they know that you're using the vanilla, out-of-the-box, basic browser, right? It doesn't have any special features, doesn't do any CSS, doesn't do any, there's nothing that it does other than get you to the website where you can download a real browser. And that's it, right? Or make it just push button. Right?
Well, there are Linux installs where as you're installing them, it goes, what browser do you want to use? And you can check, you know.
That's an option, right? The problem is that somebody would feel left out on the list.
Yeah, that's true.
And so just make it so that it's like here's a crippled... Wait, you know what? They do that. It's called Internet Explorer.
Yeah, I was going to say.
But, I mean, even worse, right? Where you just can't go anywhere else.
I can't even imagine the calls that we would get from people where they're like, my browser doesn't work right. They wouldn't switch. They would just use that one.
I guess. I think it's just sad, right? Like, if I lived my life going, here it is, right? My goal is to not really be good at what I do, but just enough to get by. Just enough to be like, you know what? I don't have to drink bleach today because you know, I was just good enough to not be a miserable failure. And that's so irritating.
It must be pretty depressing working at Bing, you know, and on the Bing team.
It's just here you go. Here's a job at a search engine that gives you inaccurate results, and nobody really wants it. Some people just don't know how to change it.
80% of our user base are just people who couldn't figure out how to change it.
That's right. Or they have Microsoft mobile device. Yeah, just you can't change it. You're just locked in for life on the wrong answer.
If you go to Google on Edge, there's a little pop-up that says, the web looks better on Chrome. Click here to download.
Yeah, and they still can't figure that out.
Yeah.
All right, let's go ahead and take a call here. Hey, Henry, how are you?
Hi. What is the starting price for a website for a business?
It kind of depends on what exactly you're looking for. We really try our best to tailor it to your budget and your needs specifically. Uh-huh. But I would say that, we have websites that are as low as $500 and as high as $5,000, depending on what you need.
Is that per year?
No, that's a one-time fee.
Oh, it's a one-time fee, uh-huh. All right. Well, that's what I needed to know right now.
Well, so, if you give me a call at the shop on Monday.
You know, what is your number? Let me get your number. I didn't think of that. Hold on.
304-8300.
He wasn't ready.
Here we go. 304 what?
8300.
8300. And who am I talking to?
This is Rob. You'll be talking to me as well if you call about
Rob,
stuff.
Okay. Are you the manager or the owner of the company?
I am not the owner, but I am the manager of the web department.
Okay, Rob.
I'm going to sit over here quietly.
The owner of the company is sitting about 2 feet to my right, though.
Oh, okay. Just ask for Rob from the website, right?
Yep. If you just mention anything about websites, they'll just immediately send you over to me.
Okay, Rob. Thank you.
Yep. No problem.
Is that my phone making all that noise?
I think so.
That's what they do at the shop. If the customer even says website, they're just like, you got to talk to Rob.
Yep. Pretty much. And then if you email me and it has the word website in it, I just forward it
there's
to Rob.
There's filters, yeah. Anything that even mentions. It contains the string WEB. Just goes right to me.
Yeah. Rob is the website dude at the office there. So, call and talk to Rob, 304-8300. Happy to help you out. It's what we do. That's an interesting picture you got on the screen there, but let's go for it.
Love this song.
Time to take a break. We'll be right back after these messages.
Small things, true care, truth brings. I'll take one lift, your ride, best trip. Always, I know, you'll be at my show.
Computer troubles? Need some advice? Call in now. Mike Swanson will be back after these messages. The Computer Guru Show, AM 1030, KVOY, The Voice.
A lot of chair problems going into here today. All right. 790-2040 if you want to be part of the show. Welcome back, by the way. So, all right, Rob pulled up an article. Netflix, download them, save them.
Well, apparently it's Amazon Prime as well, Amazon Prime Video and Netflix. There's a new Chrome bug which lets you capture the stream and have the movies offline.
But Netflix allows you to do that, too.
Well, apparently Netflix, in response, was just like, oh, how about we just let you download the movies that you like?
Here's a button. Download them.
Can you cross the streams, too?
You never cross
generally
the streams.
Generally find that's a bad idea.
Yeah, you never cross the streams.
And I just, you know, I'm just like, or you could just torrent movies like a normal person.
Or just rent them or buy them from the store like a normal person.
Is that what normal people do?
Yeah.
So that's what I'm saying, is I think that your idea of normal is maybe slightly different than normal.
I just think that this is like a pretty roundabout way to be downloading movies. That's all I'm saying.
Okay, sure. All right, so Kent is going to give us somebody here in a second.
There's a bunch of calls all of a sudden.
Suddenly everybody's calling. They wait until
the last
well,
segment.
We've got 7 minutes left in the show.
Let's the article ahead. Of this from this Netflix story didn't have much substance anyway, so.
Yeah, they're just like, hey, you can do it. We're not going to tell you how. Yeah,
the article has no links to like an extension you're supposed to use or.
Or how it's done.
It's just, and they call it a hack.
You know what is a hack?
That writer.
Besides the writer, is that there's a garage in Poland that has been using a Commodore 64 to run their business for 25 years.
Apparently that's more common than people think. Yeah. I remember hearing about a school that was using a Commodore to control their AC.
That's insane. All right. So we're starting with three. Let's talk to Roy. Hello, Roy. How are you?
I have a Epson 4320 printer.
Okay.
And it's probably 3 years old at least. And I used to be able to get the cartridges refilled at Costco.
Right.
And when you put them in, you know, they would tell you on the little screen there that these weren't any good or some other nonsense. But there was a way to get around it. And Costco gave you the instructions on the envelope how to lie to it, and it would work.
Right.
And then I got an update on the Epson probably,
sometime between the last time you got the ink and now?
And now it won't accept the cartridges no matter what you do to it.
Yeah.
And so
seems to be a trend recently.
Yeah.
Luckily, you can take the cartridges back to Costco and they give you your money back for the refills. But, I mean, there's got to be some way that you can beat that system.
Well, one of which is stop using inkjet printers.
Well, yes.
You know, because inkjets are just, it's a waste of money.
I think Costco sells laser jet printers.
They do sell laser printers. The idea of using ink is it's too expensive. However, as with everything, you can roll back to the previous update, right? You can take the firmware back a version, which will then allow you to go back to using those cartridges using the same sort of workaround procedures that you used before. Now, it's different for each printer, but yes, you can roll that back to an older version if you need to.
If Epson specifically disabled that on this version, it's likely that there are other people who are experiencing this, and I bet you could figure out how to do it on their forums.
And I also read that there's some kind of a chip in the cartridge that you should make sure that it gets replaced when they refill them. Is that true?
Well, yeah, and that's the whole, that chip that's in there is what's making it so that the cartridge doesn't work, because it knows that it's not a genuine, you know, cartridge. As far as it knows how many pages have been printed on that cartridge, and it's complaining about that.
So if the chip is replaced, will it supposedly work then?
Yeah, it should.
I see.
So, but really, you probably spend more money on ink than you do on having a decent printer. So I would suggest look at a laser printer because they're way cheaper to operate overall.
And yeah, I've got a black and white laser printer, but it's doesn't print both sides, and that's the only reason I bought that Epson, because it prints both sides of the paper.
All the new ones will do duplex printing. So if you get yourself a decent, you know, laser printer, you're going to save yourself a bunch of time and hassle.
And what brand would you suggest that's reasonable?
I don't really suggest brands. I suggest dollar amounts.
Okay, dollar amounts.
So I'm thinking when it comes to like a decent laser printer, you should be looking $250.
I was going to say I'd spend like $250.
Yeah, somewhere around there you're going to get a decent machine.
And that'll print both sides?
Most of them will. And you can just make sure that it has a duplex feature, which most do these days. And in that price range, they should all duplex.
Okay. Thank you so much.
All right. Thanks for the call.
Love your show.
Thank you very much. I appreciate it.
Bye.
We get a little bit of hate on the internet for the show sometimes. But
every now and then.
Yeah. But it's,
haters going to hate, man. Yeah. What can you do?
Sometimes you just got to be silly. Sometimes you just got to do what you do. Which is what we're going to do right now.
Because that's what we do.
Apparently.
Yeah, that's right. Oh, okay. So let's take a moment to do some, you know, housekeeping and other guru-related items. There you go. Yeah, he's.
Oh, are we putting our sunglasses on?
Yeah.
Ken's got his deal with it glasses on.
Let's put mine on as well. There we go.
There you go.
60% cooler.
So let's Rob, 73% on point 80% of the time. All right, so there are things that we need to talk about which are guru-related because,
money. They keep us coming back here.
Yeah, money is involved. So, first of all, let's take a moment to mention our sponsors for the week, which are Perfection Auto Works, who is a great sponsor we're very happy about, and they do great work for us, and we appreciate what they do. And get your 26-point inspection. There you go.
It's a lot of points, and they do that for free.
Yeah, all the points. I don't know if it's all of them, but it's 26 of them.
Maybe they do 28 points, but they only charge you for the last two. No, I don't think
so. No, they don't. All 26 for free.
You buy 26 for free, you get two free?
Yeah. Maybe.
Now, when they say points, do they mean that, like, is it like a game? Like, there's point systems?
No, or? It's crucial points of your car.
You know who else is sponsoring us this week?
Who's that?
Desert Pro Commercial Cleaning LLC, the best Tucson janitorial services. You can find them at TucsonDesertPro.com.
Let me tell you how they're supporting us. They're supporting us on Patreon. So you can, too. Go to GuruShow.com/Patreon.
Or Patreon.com/GuruShow.
And you'll have the opportunity to donate as little as a dollar a week.
Dollar a month, actually.
A dollar a month, I'm sorry. And you could do a dollar a week, though.
Yeah, if you wanted to. That'd be cool.
That would be greatly appreciated. There's also the opportunity to make Tara say anything you want.
And nobody's done it yet.
I can't believe that nobody's
done it. And contrary to what people might think, this money doesn't just go into my slush fund, although I would like for it to. We actually do spend it on the show and on advertising and buying software that we need to make stuff better, as well as making Tara say things in theory.
Theoretically speaking?
You know, I contribute a dollar a month to the show.
Did you?
I always have.
Oh, then you should be able to make
that. And I have not even taken advantage of that.
I know.
I could make her say that I'm the best co-host.
The other thing that you can do is you can bring your computers down to us at the shop at 510 East Fort Lowell or 64 North Harrison in Tucson, Arizona. That way you have the opportunity to let us work on your computer. Or if you have a business, you can have us come to you. Consultations are free. You can give us a call down at the shop at 304-8300. Also, if you need a new website.
Yeah, I'm happy to build it. I like building websites so much, I went and got a job doing it.
There you go.
So...
Yeah, and unlike everyone else at the shop, that's pretty much Rob's only job.
Yeah, you'd think that. And then Mike's like, here, program this Raspberry Pi.
Well, it was for web-based.
He's like, you do web stuff, and then just throws things at me.
Here, web boy, do this. That's what I say.
The amazing web boy. It's like dollar store Spider-Man. I'm web boy.
Need a comic.
According to that commercial, you're rocking Rob, so you might as well do this too.
Yeah, I guess so. You're going to have me working on rockets next?
Yes.
Yeah.
That'd be kind of cool.
It's not rocket science. Oh, wait, it is.
It's not rocket science. Nothing that we do.
I do, however, excel at building websites, no matter how long it takes me to do Raspberry Pi-related stuff. I'm really good at doing the websites, you know.
So, yeah, give us a call down at the shop if you have any technology questions. We can help you out with just about anything that we put in front of you. And if we can't help you, we will certainly let you know.
You should
point you in the right direction.
You should go check out our YouTube channel as well, which you can get to by going to GuruShow.com. There's going to be two episodes up today because I didn't do last week's.
Yeah, yeah. I'm not blaming that entirely on you this time,
though. Not all of it was my fault. No. Only the last 50%.
Or is it the first 50%?
No, because that was when we didn't get the podcast.
Oh, I see. Well, thanks for listening to Computer Guru Show. We really appreciate your patronage and you listening and your just general support. We'll see you next week.